Yeah, thank you.
Welcome to the research on this February 17th. I will introduce our guest speaker for the day and then pass it over to her. So with us today, we have Dr. Andrea Milwaukee. And she teaches architectural design, history, and theory here in Clemson, before coming to Clemson. She taught at Mississippi State University, Virginia Tech, Cal Poly, and the Catholic University of America. Many different places. Her areas of interest as a scholar, designer, and educator cover the history and theory of architecture, representation, and visual culture in Western and Eastern Europe, European contexts, from the second half of the 20th century to the present. Matters of corporeality and embodiment in architecture and visual arts, collective and individual memory, domesticity in everyday, philosophy, and aesthetics. She believes in conjectural and speculative thinking, fully anchored in and supported by historical research. Her research has been published in edited volumes and journals and presented at national and international conferences. Dr. Milwaukee's current doctoral research examines the architecture and visual arts in the United States during the middle decades of the 20th century from the perspective of boredom. Specifically, she unpacks three ways of understanding Robert Venturi's motto, less is a bore, in relation to habitus, flatness, and the interesting. She parallels Venturi and Scott Brown's approach to architecture with the work of the architect-artist Saul Steinberg. And finally, Milwaukee is a registered architect in Bucharest, Romania, where she remains a small architectural practice. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I'll turn it over now.
Thank you for the introduction, and thank you, Cynthia, for inviting me to the seminar. I was saying earlier that this is such an interesting doctoral program that we have here at Clemson. This research is actually part of a larger project, the book manuscript that I'm currently working on for University of Virginia Press, and it really looks at three architects, artists, designers, Ferenc Rudowski, Robert Venturi, that I'll be talking about today, and so, Almi, Lalibela, Nasidia, Stevia. What do we mean when we talk about boredom? Closely examined in philosophy, aesthetics, social sciences, critical theory, literary studies, and visual arts, boredom has remained ambiguous, vague, very defined, and rarely acknowledged in architecture, where nothing qualified as boring deserves further attention. The rejection of boredom, however, fueled the mid-century reaction against modernism, but little is known about the complicated presence of this mood in the architecture discourse. In one of the most famous indirect architecture exchanges, to Ludwig Mies van der Rohe's less is more, Robert Venturi retorted less is a bore. As a footnote, Ludwig Mies van der Rohe is one of the fathers of modern architecture, and he allegedly sort of came up with a motto, with this mantra of modern architecture, less is more, that we essentially know today in every single aspect of pop culture. Whereas Robert Venturi, around 1966, reports back saying, less is a bore. And Venturi is essentially considered to be the father of postmodernist in architecture, a label that he never Far from being a mere rhetorical tool, as it is generally assumed, Venturi's interest in boredom was influenced by his reading of a book that he referenced repeatedly in Complexity and Contradiction in Architecture. This is probably one of the last architecture treatises of the 20th century that he publishes in 1966, and where his motto, less is a bore, is published for the first time. Anybody's interested, I can pass it around. So the book is a collection of sort of what architecture should be. It's a direct critique of modern architecture and presents a number of principles for the future of architecture. And the last chapter includes some of the projects of Venturi's firm designed to sort of clearly exemplify the principles described in the book. So his interest in boredom, I contend, was influenced by his reading of a very particular book, August Heckscher's The Public Happiness, which was published in 1962. A liberal writer and political activist, Heckscher situated boredom at the core of modernity's humanity alienation. While the concern with boredom was explicitly addressed in the humanities, I suggest that it was taking shape in mid-century architecture polemics under the influence of writings from other disciplines, as well as from the emerging artistic practices that were deliberately embracing the aesthetics of boredom. More specifically, today I will examine my Jewish reading of Heckscher through two of his unused projects that directly engage the issue of boredom. And these projects are Three Buildings for the Town of North Canton, Ohio, and the project for the Copley Square Competition Cluster. So I propose to examine Venturi's paradoxical interest in boredom, its simultaneous dismissal and acceptance, through two of his designs for public spaces that I want to situate in a larger cultural context. I will show that during the middle ages of the 20th century, ennui, as a shared mood, is present on multiple levels, thus creating the underpinnings for social and artistic changes. While the visual arts directly confront boredom, both as an aesthetic strategy applied to the object and as a disposition used in the subject, architects signal its presence mainly as an indicator of the failure of modernism. And against this background, Venturi's projects that specifically address the topic of boredom invite a different meaning. And lastly, I'm raising the question that by now is probably looming large in everyone's mind. Why should we be talking about boredom, and more specifically, boredom in architecture today? The term boredom has a rather curious history. With its English etymology largely unknown, the first use is traced back to Charles Dickens' Bleak House in 1853. A complicated room, it usually evokes one's alienation from their environment and even life itself. Certain philosophers, however, have uncovered its contemplative and introspective nature, unexpectedly conducive to creativity and imagination. In the early decades of the 20th century, Walter Benjamin and Siegfried Krakauer examined the unforeseen delight hidden under the deadening appearance of tedium. Benjamin describes boredom as, quote, a warm gray fabric lined on the inside with the most lustrous and colorful of silks. And Krakauer argues that if one is patient enough in her boredom, she'll experience, quote, a kind of bliss that is almost utter. While boredom was born with modernity, it also indicates the advent of the discontent with modernity itself. In her study on boredom, Elizabeth Goodstein argues that the modern subject takes a skeptical distance from the certainties of faith, tradition, sensation, which renders the immediacy of human meaning hollow or inaccessible. This distance results in the disenchantment and disengagement with the world, a feeling that affects individuals but also larger masses that for the first time are confronted with both industrialized labor and new forms of leisure. Psychologist Orrin Clapp has proposed that the increased use of the word boredom between 1931 and 1961 indicates the growth of this mood in modern society. In the middle decades of the 20th century, boredom is experienced as a discontent with everyday life across spaces, geographies, art forms, literary genres, and history. It is a subjective as well as an objective quality of the environment. In her literary history of boredom, Patricia Meyer Sachs explains that it's an aesthetic or intellectual or emotional category, not an ethical one. Fiction and film. In his Dream Song 14, John Berryman expresses the state of mind of an entire generation. Life, friends, is boring. Alberto Moravia, known to his friends as a perpetual victim of boredom, publishes in 1960 the novel La Noia, originally translated in English as The Empty Canvas, most likely out of fear that the direct translation, boredom, would not appeal to an English-speaking audience. Dino, a painter disenchanted with life, develops a neurotic love for Cecilia, a girl who he fails to know beyond their sexual encounters. This is a still frame from the film La Noia, directed by Damiano Damiani in 1960. In an interview titled The Occident is Getting Bored, Moravia defines boredom as, quote, the product of a form of alienation, or suspending the relationship between the individual and reality, and therefore between the artist, and matter itself, or if you prefer, between the subject and the object. We are bored in the city, declares a precursor of the Situationists in 1953. What currently marks our public life is boredom. The French Art World, writes the journalist Pierre Gassopont in the March 15, 1968 issue of Le Monde. This very boredom, however, becomes the catalyst for change and builds the underlying mood for creativity and new artistic expressions. And then pen disenchantment emerges in artistic practices during this century as a conscious approach to liberate the arts from the subjectivity of emotions. Described as the aesthetics of boredom or the aesthetics of silence, this tactics invites the viewers to go beyond appearance and come into a deeper engagement with the work. The silences and dissonances of John Cage's music, the objectivity of Morsi Cunningham's choreographies, the focus on the repetitive and the ordinary in Andy Warhol's works, the affectless presence of Donald John's art, all share the same emotion, to elicit a response from the audience to an artwork completely devoid of emotions and feelings. In this space of silence lies the opportunity for wonder, new forms of criticism, and dialogue with the work. Boredom becomes a deliberate strategy of contemplation and creative judgment. The mid-century architecture discourse resonates with this overall disposition, but the meaning of boredom, however, changes. Architects are apprehensive of the normative turn of the modernist language and signal the necessity of renewal. While the visual arts employ boredom as a deliberate aesthetic strategy, there are fewer instances when it becomes operational in architecture and moves beyond rhetorical trope. The anxieties of practitioners and architecture critics alike resonate with a larger concern with boredom. In 1955, the architect and critic Bernard Rudofsky publishes Behind the Picture Window, a collection of satirical essays on everyday life in the United States. And I thought it would be nice to illustrate, actually, Rudofsky's book that doesn't have lots of images with this ad from mid-century, the ad for what was called at the time the window, so an innovative insulating glass that was specifically catered to home builders for the design of their of the picture windows. Picture window becomes very popular and sort of ubiquitous feature of suburban houses during the middle decades of the 20th century, and at the same time it sort of becomes the embodiment literally of everything that has to do with consumer culture, suburban life during the century. So in Rudofsky's book Behind the Picture Window, the concluding chapter titled On Boredom and Disprivacy criticizes the modern house as being conducive to solitude, alienation, and boredom. Rudofsky argues that the transparent walls, along with the noises produced by the mechanical systems of the house, prevent people from building intimacy, conversation, and a sense of privacy. As boredom influences on people's lives, the easiest way out appears to be the quick change, observes Rudofsky. Just as Arthur Thompson, Henry James's character from the short novel Washington Square, frequently changes his residence, so do modern individuals falsely believe that their problems will be solved by trading the current house for another one, larger yet so similar. Rudofsky echoes Søren Kierkegaard's reflections on boredom. Kierkegaard criticizes an extensive response to boredom that would involve a variation of the surface rather than a deeper and more substantial change. Bored with the countryside, he argues, people move to the city. Bored with their native lands, people go abroad. Bored with Europe, they travel to America. Bored with eating on porcelain, they eat on silver. Instead, he suggests, limitations and restraints make one more resourceful and more creative. Similarly, Rudofsky notices that the modern individuals' periodical changes of address are no more than periodical changes to escape the boredom of his environment. In the early 1960s, British architect Frederick Price, along with Joan Littlewood, a radical theater director, producer, and social activist, embarked together on the challenging adventure of designing and building what was called at the time the Fun Palace. Never built as an actual physical structure, the purpose of the Fun Palace is to merge education and leisure. Due to automation and prefabrication, the post-World War II British economy is predicted to become leisure-driven. And in this context, Price and Littlewood attempt to make both education and leisure accessible to the working class, and thus erase the modernist distinction between work and leisure. One of the underlying goals of the project is to overcome the boredom of the urban dweller, soon to be faced with too much free time and too few engaging activities. And in one of the publicity pamphlets for the Fun Palace that we have on the slide, Price and Littlewood describe the project as a remedy to the problems of tedious routines, urban boredom, and alienation. Published in 1963, Serge Chermayev and Christopher Alexander's Community and Privacy for the New Architecture of Humanism shares similar concerns with Rudowski. While the modern individual's fundamental anatomy of an anxiety-ridden existence lacks daily variety, the transparency of the walls, along with the deafening sounds of the new machines and mechanical devices, are threatening the provision for relaxation, concentration, contemplation, and introspection. As more and more becomes less and less, overstimulation leads to boredom, a state that the authors describe as a disease, whose pathology they identify in the proliferation of artificial machine control environment. At the end of the subchapter titled The Pathology of Boredom, an illustration by Saul Steinberg shows a man holding up his oversized fingerprint, perhaps a desperate attempt at preserving individuality and privacy in face of the uniformity of the air-conditioned nightmare. Architecture critic and historian Siegfried Gideon, summarizing the state of affairs in architecture during the middle of the 20th century in his introduction to the fifth edition of Space-Time and Architecture, subtitled Hopes and Fears, and he succinctly described the situation as confusion and boredom, describing the current architecture as the playboy architecture. An architecture treated as playboys treat life, jumping from one sensation to another and quickly bored with everything. And most famously, as I said at the beginning, in 1966, Robert Venturi puts less is a bore. Now, Venturi's treatise, Complexity and Contradiction in Architecture, begins with what he calls a general manifesto that includes the first references to boredom. And relevant to this topic is a particular fragment that has gone through multiple iterations. And I'm showing one of the working drafts from the archives. And what I find particularly important and interesting in this context is that on the manuscript draft, Venturi adds at the bottom of the page in a handwritten note to the sequence of elements that he likes or dislikes, the boring and the interesting. So my point is that boredom was not an accidental or a random thought or a mere rhetorical qualifier. Boring and interesting were, boring and boredom became really in specific interests of Venturi's in his work. So he adds at the bottom, boring as well as interesting, adventure rather than design. So in the final version, that was the one published in 1966, he includes the deliberate addition of boring as well as interesting. Now, in Venturi's treatise, the most cited author, actually after T.S. Eliot was really Venturi's hero, is a lesser known name, August Heckscher. An American liberal writer and political activist, Heckscher served as the chairman of the New School for Social Research, the Woodrow Wilson Foundation, the Parsons School of Design. He was a Parks Commissioner under New York Mayor John Lindsay. He was the coordinator of cultural affairs at the White House under Kennedy and served as a special consultant on the arts in the Kennedy administration. He was a trustee of the 20th Century Fund and also served as the director of the institution from 56 to 67. Committed to and deeply engaged with civic matters, Heckscher writes his book, The Public Happiness, to signal that in a world increasingly focused on the happiness of individual, larger issues such as the happiness of the state and the very idea of citizenship are being neglected. In the introduction to his book, Heckscher recounts his personal awakening to the issue of boredom and describes the real problems of our society as boredom, loneliness, and alienation. In his book, Heckscher situates collective boredom at the core of civic responsibilities. And he dedicates an entire chapter to architecture and urban issues. He suggests that in the age of communication, the profound and debilitating boredom of the modern individual emerges in response to a hostile world, and observes that the main factor contributing to this form of alienation is the built environment. between the fear of overcrowding and that of emptiness, a generalized discontent produces, quote, a psychological state where boredom succeeds to nervous agitation, end quote. Two particular chapters from Heckscher's book seem to have exercised an important influence on ritual treaties, the approach to reality, and anthropologies. So based on people's attitudes toward modern life and boredom, Heckscher identifies three typologies. Heckscher includes the individuals that he calls the true citizens of their time, who have not renounced to the pleasures of life, but they have liberated themselves from the constraints of consumers. So consumerism was a constant critique that is present across multiple writings of this beginning century. This way they are able to find the deeper meaning of existence, and they are not bored, quote, because even deceptions can be interesting to the enlightened. What all these people in this last category have in common is a view of life as essentially complex, an attitude that embraces irony, playfulness, and the philosophical paradox. Complexity, irony, playfulness, these are all ideas that will become central to Venturi's treatise. So the last chapter of the book, Complexity and Contradiction, includes 12 projects designed by the Office of Venturi and Law. And these projects exemplify design principles presented in the treatise. And the last two projects, both of them public interventions, specifically address the issue of boredom. So in 65, Venturi and Rock make a proposal for the downtown of North Kent, Ohio, hometown to the Hoover Company, the vacuum cleaners manufacturers. The intervention includes a town hall, the YMCA building, and the extension of the public library. And Venturi compares the design of the town hall with that of a Roman temple, where the giant columns and the pediment of the porch are replaced by a freestanding screen. Sitting opposite the Hoover factory, the YMCA building that we see here, you see a perspective of the building. So these are Venturi's drawings from the archives. So the YMCA building receives a false front facade, another freestanding wall resembling the one in the town hall. Its design is based on a play between different rhythms. It has no beginning, middle, or end. Quote, it is just one continuous thing resulting from the constant, even boring rhythm of the large-scale opening. So this is Venturi's description of the project. And obviously he describes the project, the chaos of the back facade, and this tension creates the circumstantial complexities of the project. While boring here seems to describe the uniformity of monotonous formal rhythms, it reflects, in fact, a larger social condition, a certain tedium of a small town, the repetitive rhythms of factory work and mass-produced goods, unfolding in the Hoover facility nearby. These freestanding walls act as screens, but also as stage sets, against which everyday life with its habits and routines takes place. A close examination of the working sketches, and these are some of them, shows not only the conventional silhouettes of people in motion that we typically see in architectural renderings, but also less predictable situations that are rarely rendered in architectural drawings at the time. We see, for instance, a person in a wheelchair with their caregiver. Toy boats floating on the pond, people skating. The rhythm of the YMCA facade, as well as the rigor of the plans designed with practicality in mind, reveal the dullness of administrative duties, while at the same time allowing everyday life to follow its own course. Boredom transcends its immediate reading as a formal device resulting from repetitive elements, and, as it did for Heckscher, opens up larger questions about modern society and the rhythms of modern life. Not unlike contemporary fellow artists, Venturi resorts to strategies of what was called at the time cool persuasion, but complicates the relationship between disinterest and engagement. To embrace everyday life with objective detachment of reason, the mission of pop artists, who Venturi admires, is also, architecturally speaking, to translate tedious routines in built form. Just as an emotionless, boring painting awakens in the viewer reactions otherwise inaccessible, so the boring rhythms of the facades create a complicity with the inhabitants and their modes of life. In its careful orchestration of the tension between order and chaos, the project celebrates what French philosopher Pierre Bourdieu has called habitus, the physical embodiment of habits, skills, and dispositions constructed upon and derived from one's life experiences. This accumulation and growth determines one's choices and preferences. Habitus describes not an individual, but a collective practice, shared and understood by the members of a social group. While the public space itself is only apparently void, it engenders a shared mood that the entire community joins in. While Heckscher has rightly recognized the drama of the built environment that generates either boredom or nervous agitation, Bertrand proposes a public space that paradoxically builds upon, yet overcomes, modern boredom. The 12th and last project shown in this book is the entry for the Kapuscinski competition in Boston, and it revolves around two issues, play and boredom. Similar to the previous project, boredom goes beyond a formal understanding of the repetitive nature of the grid. The main compositional tactic of the project is a multi-layered grid that reflects sort of the city fabric of Boston. The design of the public plaza, which you see here, reflects the everyday rhythms of life and its thickness. And multiple layers constitute this three-dimensional pattern. Alleys, trees, lampposts, and streets, furniture, as well as changes in topography. And here I'm showing just a few of the numerous sketches in which working on trace paper, Victory sort of designs layer upon layer, street furniture, different iterations of how to plant trees, what type of trees, what kind of street furniture, so on and so forth. So Venturi writes, in the context of the boring consistent grid inside the square, so he essentially proposes this very regular rhythm, the chaotic buildings to the north become interesting and vital elements of the composition. So he incorporates the existing building with his proposal. Now, drawing upon Gestalt psychology, Venturi conceptualizes the Copley Square proposal in terms of visual perception. So he was very much interested in visual perception of architecture, and the principles of Gestalt psychology sort of underlie his entire theoretical approach to design. The spatial plane that he proposes is perceived in different ways from a distance as a plane blur, and from close by as intricate, varied, and rich in pattern, texture, scale, and color. What's interesting is that Venturi's book was based on a course in architecture theory that he was teaching at the time at the University of Pennsylvania. And his lecture notes actually indicate that he was considering this relationship between Gestalt psychology and boredom. Specifically, in one of his lecture outlines, he directly discusses this topic. We see at the bottom perceptual basis, Gestalt psychology, necessity of balance, of unity with variety, boredom versus chaos, and so on. So again, his interest in boredom was consistent and underlying his theoretical approach. Boredom and chaos, two extreme positions, have a double role in the Kapuscinski project. On the one hand, they describe the nature of the built environment, and on the other hand, they reflect the nature of life itself. Venturi discusses two lifestyles, the American and the European one, in relation to the nature of public space. While Europeans spend time outdoors in the city in long passeggiatas, Americans prefer to stay home watching TV. Prior to publishing this book, Venturi was a fellow at the American Academy in Rome. He was from his family was of Italian descent, and he very much appreciated and studied Italian art. Now, he replaces the boring open plaza dear to modern architects, but no longer relevant for contemporary life, with a thick plane, boring only in name. And again, he concludes the description of this project by saying that the main paradox of this design is that the boring pattern is interesting. The rhetoric of boredom concludes Venturi's description of the Copley Square project. He extends the critique of open spaces in the city to the emptiness of the parking lots, the deserts of urban renewal, and the harmless suburbs around. Heckscher has deprived the alienating transition from barrenness to crowdedness in public spaces. The jury's response is to address this void that is both spatial and social through the density of a what calls the non-kyatsa that offers a variety of experiences, perceptions, and relationships. He proposes rich explorations of public spaces that address the issue of collective order. While privileging visual relationships, the projects bring forward materials, textures, in a specific concern for understanding people's habitus and ways of life. Unlike most of his peers, who use boredom as a rhetorical trope, Venturi employs it as a design strategy. Through repetitive rhythms, the public spaces thus created echo the cadences and tempos of ordinary lives that unfold in specific details from paper boats floating in a pool to nursery rhymes inscribed on the wall. While the design is not boring, a deliberate monotony invites the inhabitants to pause, examine, and reflect. At a time when artists attempt to stimulate their audiences through an art that uses stimuli sparingly, Venturi challenges the potential occupants of these public spaces to ponder over their own lives and environments. He uses the modern language to critique the modernist architectural paradigm. Boredom thus becomes a vehicle for introspection that creates the distance necessary to engage critically with the work. With a fast pace of changing contemporary practices, the conversation about boredom continues to stay relevant in the architecture discourse today. Confronted simultaneously with visual overload and scarcity of meaning, people feel alienating from themselves and their places. This sense of estrangement results from both the dull and generic architectural production and the impersonal presence of iconic buildings. An open conversation about contemporary unmeaning invites to further explorations of moods, dispositions, affects, all ambiguous yet essential characteristics of the built environment. At its worst, boredom is the malaise of the modern individual. At its best, it offers an unexpected potential for contemplation, reflection, and critical judgment. Thank you.
I was in New York City last week and noticed that a lot of the new buildings that I saw going up had that kind of layering concept that you were talking about. Is that a reflection of what the architects see in society now? I mean, it just, could you put that together?
Probably. I think it's also, depending on the building, I'd say, I'm not sure what particular building you have in mind, but technology is also a critical, a key component of what's happening in architecture today. So the relationship of the architect with technology, of the inhabitants with technology, is critical in how we perceive, understand, conceive of architecture. So oftentimes, technology allows us to sort of whimsically display things just because we can. So there's a real danger, I think, in this sort of meaningless and constant change of things, display of images, and unfortunately, this is what architecture is today, or most of it is today, is a constant display of images. It's about creating images that do not go past the sort of flat and thin surface without actually considerations about human perception, individuals, inhabitation, and how we as individuals, as human beings, really relate with the space, indoors or outdoors.
They're trying to say something. So you're relating it to their concept of images? And
I related a lot with the concept of image and sort of, in a way, what Siegfried Gideon was talking in the 60s, interestingly enough, things haven't changed too much since then, this idea of the Playboy architecture that is in constant change and only looking for fads and trends. So I find this a very, very strong progression that architecture has taken today.
What do you think about the Apple headquarters building?
I think it embodies the same idea, the sort of the disappearance of the walls. Everyone is in the public sphere. It's sort of constant visibility. We see each other, others see others, all the others see us. So I think it actually embodies in many ways the spirit of the time. And what, there was an interest, the book itself is not necessarily of great value, but a couple of years ago, Dave Eggers published a book called The Circle, I think it was. There was also a movie that was out after the book. I haven't seen the movie, but I've heard it was really bad. That discusses a utopian world toward which we're actually moving quite fast, in which everything depends upon our presence on the web or presence online. We exist as long as we like, dislike things, as long as we have an image. So it's like, the book was modeled on the physical environment was modeled after Google or Apple headquarters. Sort of the environments that these companies create.
Okay, so thank you very much for your talk. It's particularly interesting to me because I'm also studying Gestalt psychology in music. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the ideas that you talked about here are synonymous with what I'm reading about in emotion and meaning in music by Leonard Meyer. So you talked about sort of this genericism. Predictability helps music make sense in a syllogistic way, but only when it features deviation. Otherwise, it leads to this sort of boredom and lack of critical engagement. And so the notion is that it's good for it to be predictable because it gives you a sense that you're able to predict what's coming next, and that builds confidence. But too much of that can lead to a point where you're not critically engaging with your own ideas, because this is universal with pattern recognition. It's not just with architecture, and it's not just with music. So we need deviation in our environments in order to remain critically engaged. So I really appreciate this. It makes a lot of sense to me.
I haven't specifically talked about this, but there's a super interesting contemporary cultural theorist, Cheyenne Jay, writes about what she calls our new aesthetic categories. She actually has a book called New Aesthetic Categories, Zany, the Cute, and the Interesting. And her argument is that the extensive use of the notion of interesting, particularly during mid-century, is part of this idea of creating the critical distance from the work. So through repetibility, through repetition, through predictability, we are creating a certain mood that eventually opens up a critical dialogue with the work. And she discusses at length this notion of interesting as through its ambiguity and vagueness, as a way to actually have, as a way to really open a dialogue. So, you know, in the same way we talk about something and say, oh, that's interesting. It's not good nor bad, but it really is something that invites a dialogue. It opens up this space of critical thinking. And to me, what I find interesting, again, what I find interesting about this, the conversation about the boredom is that, to me, at least, it opens up exactly this or sort of similar avenues of discussion.
I was intrigued by the question about the picture window. Mm-hmm. Because I've been thinking about the role of the picture window in an American residential architecture, suburban architecture. And I've been thinking about the voyeurism and exhibitionism that kind of work through this picture window. And always thinking, you know, is it a window onto the world or is it a screen of some sort? And lately I've been thinking about, you know, this idea of mediation as filtration or screening. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on the specifics of the picture window as a means of mediation, and if yes, then what is being mediated and in what direction, what is the directionality of the picture window? And then if not mediation, if it's more filtration or screening a way of, then I would also
incidentally that specifically this idea, that's exactly what I'm working on right now.
Oh great.
So that comes in as a great topic. So the picture window is very interesting. So it emerges in the United States, and interestingly enough, the first time the term is used is by Henry Victor Stowe in the 19th century. And originally, its meaning is rather ambiguous. So at the beginning, it refers to a window, a stained glass window that depicts a picture. So we look at a window and we see a picture. And it's only in the 20s and 30s that with modern architecture, that it begins to open up, ideally toward the landscape. So the original intention was to really connect the indoors and the outdoors. So there's a sort of ethos about the American character that is embodied in this relationship between the indoors and the outdoors, and the picture window sort of facilitates this connection. Right after World War II, with all the technological progress, manufacturers begin to, and there's a specific glass manufacturer, his name escapes me right now, glass manufacturers begin to advertise the new technology of the picture window as a way of, as you see here, as a way of creating this artificial environment. So the picture window, one of the main characteristics of the picture window is that it's not operable. So the picture window is typically fixed, you can't open it. So you have the inhabitant of the house has your relationship with the exterior is that of a spectator. So you're no longer really engaged with the landscape. You're looking at the landscape, but you're outside it. At the same time, with the suburbanization of America that again starts during the century, the original idea of the picture window as opening toward the landscape is completely lost. And there's a lot of criticism that begins actually around the same time about the picture window opening toward another picture window. So it ends up being a distinct sign of consumer culture. So the entire, like the suburban houses are all feature these picture windows as an ideal of modern living. So it's a combination of, again, all these ads brand the picture window as the ideal living situation of the modern American family. And then again, it's very interesting because exactly at the same time, architectural critics, let's say the highbrow architectural culture, criticizes the emergence of this trend in architecture, while on the other hand, developers and glass manufacturers push toward more and more an increased use of this feature for suburban houses. I've been thinking a lot about the relationship of the picture window with the front lawn. To me, they're sort of, in a way, directly related, and both of them create a stage set. So you are staging both your life inside the house for the outsiders, but you're also sort of the front lawn is staged as the sort of perfect, ideal, yet artificial environment. So I do think it has to do with, it's not necessarily a filter, as I think it is a mediation. And Rudofsky's comments about the lack of privacy is something that is becoming to be very present in the conversation about picture windows, because on the one hand, you are exposing yourself to the world while trying to stay behind. So I guess about voyeurism and mediation, I think, are really, really critical to this picture of the suburban house. Where I think that Rudofsky, for instance, goes a step further beyond sort of the conventional criticism of the picture window as a sign of consumer culture, is that he really makes the connection with notions of atmosphere, mood, and specifically boredom. And there's a whole literature about the boredom of the suburban wife who lives in her house. There is actually a very interesting book called The Crack in the Picture Window. The author is John Keats, and he's a journalist, so he writes this sort of popular novel where he follows a suburban family, husband, wife, and two children, who are called, the drones. Yes, the drones. He follows them in their suburban house, a suburban development, where all the houses look alike, and all the wives do the same things. So, as I said, where I think Rudofsky observes something that nobody else has, was that it's not just that the picture window is not only a matter of consumer culture, but again, generates this underlying mood of suburban life, which is boredom.
I thought about the picture window too a lot, but maybe a different aspect. And that was really, I started thinking about what you're saying about the relationship between boredom and space itself, and that boredom versus chaos is another, is a variation of boredom versus cluttered space. So if you have a picture window and your house maybe is cluttered, you're adding space to an otherwise cluttered place. But also, if you have an open space and the picture window opens up to you more space, let's say you're minimalist, thinking of the house in Parasite, mm-hmm. and you saw the film, and you've got this big picture window that opens up to the lawn, very minimalist inside. But you have to be the one, people have to produce the meanings inside those spaces versus the clutter or the chaos of, say, a European small space, even with the picture window. So space itself, opening it up, either by a view or a picture window, changes somehow the production of meaning, does it? Maybe that's a question I'm asking.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this is where this conversation about habitus comes into place. So modes of inhabitation and the practice of living and the practice of inhabitation that is not a passive act, but it's really in a way taking charge of your life, of your work. And at the same time, these practices are embodied practices. So oftentimes you're not really conscious about them. They have more from time, from childhood, but they are part of how space is perceived and how meaning is created. So again, absolutely. The notion of happiness to me is critical in this understanding of the meaning of space and the dwelling and the habitation. There's also, this is an irrelevant detail, but the fact that the picture window is not an operable window, essentially what it does, it divides the original function of the window, which is closed to see through, but also to air circulation, it splits it into two. So all of a sudden, air ventilation is especially during the century, is relegated to mechanical systems, right? So at this particular point, the inhabitant of the house no longer has this kind of active relationship with the house. Literally, you come out the window. That doesn't exist anymore. You push a button and you turn on the AC.
And this is fascinating to me, that the window becomes, you know, a very aesthetic element within...
It's like an optic device.
Right. And that's why I'm thinking about it in terms of screen, because I'm thinking about it during nighttime and from the outside. You know, how when the night, you know, shrouds the world in darkness, then these big picture windows are complete glass walls in mid-century architecture or in postmodern architecture become illuminated as large screens. And then projecting onto those outside whatever is happening inside. And in a suburban sprawl, it might be sort of a repetitive, tedious routine of the families inside who are, you know, unwinding, getting ready for bed. But my mind, and everyone in this room is aware of it, has been lately burdened by this one nonfiction book about a prowler and a sex offender who lives outside and looks into mid-century, very modern houses in Sacramento, California, in a specific architecturally exciting part of town, and using indeed the architecture to carry out surveillance of specific women within those houses, and then carrying out specific crimes. But it's interesting that the police reports comment on the mid-century house design as the
facilitator
of this, you know, criminal obsession with peeping and then, you know, moving on to other acts from peeping. But so it's interesting to think of the picture window as also a screen that has a very, very different function, even if it's aesthetic, both from the inside and the outside. But the outside and how they function for the viewers outside is less, is it less also critically written upon? So the view, you know,
into the house, not that I'm very familiar with, not that I come across a lot. That's a good point. What is an interesting discussion is the notion of privacy, right? That obviously comes with, or lack thereof, that comes with the picture window. And there's an interesting book on architecture, on design of the house that comes out in 1945. It's a book specifically catered to home builders. And it looks at every element of the house, windows, doors, different spaces, rooms within the house. And the entire conversation about windows is this exciting, enthusiastic praise of uses of glass in modern architecture. It doesn't specifically mention the term picture window, but it's all about reading between the lines, it's all about picture window. And it brings pros and cons to the use of large glass walls and things like that. And in the end, sort of discussing about the notion of privacy, it says, well, but that's really not an issue because there's nothing more beautiful than a house with curtains, but a big wall with curtains. So in a way, sort of going against the very idea of the picture window. So the messages that are out there to the public are quite mixed. Another, this time an architecture critic, again, mid to late 40s, in an exhibition at MoMA in New York, exhibition about sort of the house of the future, the house of tomorrow, quickly dismisses the notion of picture window as being, she calls it the silly artifice of the picture window. So already around that time, there's this tension again between high-brow culture and low-brow culture, how and what this means, what this whole architecture future means.
I was fascinated like privacy, but also surveillance, because like the washing machine and how that translates into this like minimalist office space, like the idea of like no walls drawing board was like, could be a positive thing if interrupted to like critically think about like your life, but it can also be sort of like playing wise, like a form to like, if you like insert a person into certain like streams of action, they get bored and like don't think too critically about the world around them too. So I was wondering if you've seen anything about like the present place of boredom with like all the social like open space and surrealism.
Not specifically about, but this is a really interesting. I think that's again one of the possible directions to investigate. What's interesting is that this past Friday I was literally just came across an article published by a British psychologist and philosopher, his name is Neil Burton, and he writes about boredom so in this sort of contemporary direction of research that looks at boredom as an opportunity for contemplation and reflection. In other words, in a nutshell, the argument is that, okay, we are in a world overloaded with stimuli, it's particularly visual stimuli, so taking a break from that would actually allow us to reconnect with ourselves, with the world, with what is more meaningful. There's a whole lot of literature, particularly philosophy and psychology, contemporary psychology, children's psychology mostly, that sort of recommends boredom as a deliberate strategy for, you know, refinding our place in the world. But the question of office spaces, and again, it's around mid-century that the open plan of office buildings becomes more prominent, is definitely one that is worth the image that comes to mind is Jacques Tati's Playground, you see the movie? That is a direct critique of modern architecture in general, and some of the scenes actually are filmed in what appears to be sort of an endless sea of office cubicles in a public space.
Do any of these concepts, this reason in your research, do they relate to, this is off the subject a little bit, to relate to the concept of designing cars? Because cars are, there's so many cars are so uniform and so, they look so much alike. Like, you look at a Mercedes and a BMW and a Honda, and there's so many that have the same exact style or look. And that's boring to me. And
to be honest, I'm not familiar. There might be something out there, but it hasn't come to my attention. I haven't come across anything like that. But maybe I'm not looking in the right places. Again, there might be something in that direction, but I'm really not aware of it.
I mean, the wild cars now that come out in design are like these supercars that don't look very practical, but there's no reason that they or some of their elements could be attributed and put into the car that the people, because we spend so much, I lived in California a lot of years, and I've commuted way more than I'd like to admit, and you spend, you know, 3-4 hours a day in a car, and it becomes a second home to you.
Yeah, that's an interesting, I haven't thought about it, so maybe that's why,
I'm just obsessed with cars, that's my problem.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you might have found your next research project. We only have like a minute left, so if there's any final questions.